Speed Channel welcomes you to Atlanta Motor Speedway, where tonight the NASCAR Winston Cup Series squares off in Bud Pole qualifying. As the sun dips in the west and the temperatures cool, it's an optimum night for speed. Not just Speed Channel, but 200 mile an hour corner entry speeds at this, NASCAR's now fastest track. Elliott Sadler will be the first to test the mile and a half Atlanta Motor Speedway, and the rest of the Winston Cup Series best is ready to roll. Let's go right down to where tension mounts, and they're ready to race. Dave Burns.
And Mike, the guy who took this very fast speedway, the fastest in qualifying practice, was again Ryan Newman. Ryan, going for your ninth pole. What do you think the chances are?
We'll have to see what the track's like and everything else. I mean, obviously the car's fast. Alto Mobile 1 Dodge is unloaded fast off the truck. Man, the guy's done an awesome job. The guy's back in the shop. Just a matter of getting that one lap right, and that's what it's going to take to be on the pole here.
All right, he goes for pole number 9 tonight. To Matt Yocum.
Dave, directly behind Ryan Newman on the grid and the speed charts is rookie Brian Vickers. You continue to impress. Now, you talked to Jeff Gordon after practice. How much is left in the car and how much is left in you for qualifying?
I think there's a little bit in both, hopefully. You know, Jeff and I talked about it, and he helped me a lot. You know, I think I was overdriving this corner a little bit. I backed it up, and that helped. And I was driving a little bit harder than he was down there, and he sped it up, and that helped. So it actually worked out really well. But we're going to go out there, do the best we can, and just get a good, solid qualifying.
Some guys are pulling double duty. You're pulling triple duty.
Yeah, that's right. You know, we're after the Busch race, their Victory Junction Game Camp is doing a walk around the racetrack with all the drivers. I like to see as many people get out there as they can. It's a great cause. And, you know, I'm very excited about that and very excited about this deal as well. You know, the UAW, the chance they gave me with the cup.
Qualified fifth in his Busch Series car, a big weekend, second in practice. And guess what? Today, he turned 20. He still can't rent a car, Mike.
But he sure can go fast in one. Hi, everybody. Mike Joy, Larry McReynolds, and Jeff Hammond with you once again at what is now NASCAR's fastest track. And a lot of stories here tonight. Some drivers making debuts. The future status of hometown hero Bill Elliott. And the change to nighttime qualifying. They tried it last year. It got rained out, Larry. What's going to happen as we move qualifying from the heat of the afternoon to the coolness of night?
Well, everything about this race car is going to love it. One, it's going to make more power with the cool air with the engine. Plus, the racetrack is going to have much more grip. They're going to run much quicker through the corner. Now, the track record is down at about 197 miles per hour. That's when the racetrack was brand new asphalt. But I would say that we probably are going to get over 195 miles per hour when qualifying comes. I talked to some teams that tested down here, and at those speeds, at the end of the straightaway, entering the corner was almost 207 miles per hour. This is at a mile and a half racetrack.
That is fast. Jeff, we're going to get a preview of the 2004 season beginning here tonight as some drivers have already moved on and established camp for next season.
That's right, Mike. One of the guys we've already talked to happens to be Brian Vickers in the 25 car. So when you start checking your scorecards, guys and girls, make sure you pay attention to the driver. Right now, Brian Vickers is in the 25 car, second fastest today. Right now, Joe Nemechek, who was driving the 25 car, is in the 01. He was 19th fastest. Ward Burton is in the 0 car. And Scott Wimmer is now in the 22 car instead of Ward Burton. So you've got to pay attention to who's on the racetrack and what's going on. But the big thing, Mike, is these guys are basically getting themselves accustomed to the crew chiefs. They're trying to get a feel for next year. They're really getting tuned up for 2004 already. So tonight will be a good indication of how really good they are.
Now I know why there was such a line out front to buy programs as people were coming in. So much is changing, and already. We're set to go with Bud Pole qualifying here from Atlanta Motor Speedway as Greg Biffle signs a few on the way out to his car. Speed Channel coverage of Bud Pole qualifying from Atlanta Motor Speedway is brought to you by Backyard Wrestling. Break out of the ring and into the future of wrestling at Backyard Wrestling. Don't try this at home for PlayStation 2 and Xbox. Kenny Schrader is ready to rock it. The man is a picture of tension. He anticipates the speed. He's ready to go. He's snoring.
Just a little nap before running 193.
Yeah, but I thought you guys kept saying that the drivers get nervous around here. Somebody forgot to tell Schrader that.
You know what? I love that. But Neil Bonnett used to do that. Neil Bonnett lay down in the garage, prop his head up in a wheel still attached to the car, and fall straight asleep. Show me a fellow that can fall asleep 1 second and be doing 205 miles an hour the next. That is a rare talent.
Oh, he really is. And when you want to drive a race car better than 200 miles an hour, you need to be able to have those kind of calm nerves and calm times as we see right now. Elliott Sadler, who's looking to bounce back after a couple weeks of bad luck, isn't he, Larry?
And if you look close at this car, you see it looks like about 1,000 or better signatures on it. What this is signatures of employees of the M&M's Corporation, M&M's Mars.
Pace chase is in. Rolls off into the corner.
197 miles per hour going into turn one. Remember, you're not totally up to speed the first time you get to turn one.
How fast and how bright they look under the lights. It's pretty neat.
I still say anytime you get an opportunity to watch a race under the lights, that's the best place to go because these cars take center stage so much. Elliott Sadler takes one lap, and his first lap is going to be 28.854, about 192.14 miles an hour.
Well, his last four starts, first at Talladega, 10th at Kansas, 7th at Lowe's, and 38th at Martinsville, where he didn't get through inspection.
He picked up a little over a tenth from practice, so we would expect maybe cars to pick up a little bit more than that, but I think he didn't get up to speed maybe as quick. We saw that on the miles per hour getting into turn one.
And Larry, talking to a lot of the crew chiefs down there after this afternoon practice, they were really concerned about how they were going to try to adapt this racetrack under the lights this first time. And they were going back to a lot of the Lowe's Motor Speedway notes, which this racetrack here in Atlanta has a lot like Lowe's. So they were referencing back their notes. So for a lot of them, they were trying to guess what kind of adjustments to make.
Well, there's a couple things that goes on. One, you got to be careful you're not geared too low when the racetrack picks up speed and you exceed that RPMs where it makes the maximum power. The other thing, you drive off in the corner so much harder with more grip. There's such a bump down in turn one and in the middle of three and four, the car will bottom out because of more speed. The car traveling more getting in the corner. That can be a real challenge.
It really can, especially with that big hump in turn one. The amount of speed you carry down in there, you start bottoming out. We're going to see a lot of sparks probably before the night's all said and done. A lot of guys are going to be happy about this change. Several guys are going to be probably unhappy because they're going to miss making those adjustments and they're not going to be happy with the results in the end.
Michael Waltrip will be our second qualifier, the Napa Chevy. One top 10 finish on quad oval tracks, and it came here in 1997 for the Wood Brothers. He has qualified 14th for tomorrow's Aaron's 312 Busch Series race.
Michael was 20th quickest in practice. You see, he's only the second car through one and two. He was green, a little quicker than Elliott Sadler, losing a little ground off turn two down the backstretch. Sometimes when you're in the throttle as much as you are at a racetrack like this, sometimes it looks like you're getting out horsepower on the straightaway, but what really going on is the car wants to push off the corner and kills the speed at the beginning of the straightaway.
And Michael's done after one lap, 29.005. It's about 1,500 slower than Elliott Sadler. Dave?
And there's one of the employees of Master Foods Now. Gus, if you wonder where he's been working, well, there he is. Let's talk to Elliott Sadler. We were talking about how difficult to set up from this afternoon to now. How different did your car feel than your last practice run?
You know, we've never qualified here at night, so I really didn't know what to expect with the M&M's forward, but the track's a lot looser. Man, we were loose. And I tightened the car up, and didn't expect that. I guess the front grips so much better than what you expected to do during the afternoon. It just makes the tail all over the place. But that was a pretty decent lap. I'm going to be happy with that. Hopefully that'll be in the top 10 to 12 somewhere, and we'll go from there. But guys gave me a great car, great motor again, and just glad to have these colors back with me this weekend.
All right, Elliott back on pit road with Gus behind him.
And a whole lot of signatures there.
He's awake. Maybe not, yeah. Maybe he's awake for good. He didn't hit the snooze button.
Boy, I did this morning.
But I want you to just notice our first two cars, they only ran one lap. This is a two-lap qualifying session, but these guys know that with the fresh new tires, when it's going to really happen, unless you really mess that first lap up, it's going to happen on the first lap.
Jeremy Mayfield behind the Dodge dealer's Intrepid of Ray Evernham, number 19. And the big news here is that he will be back with this team next year and with contract worries and rumor mill issues have suddenly died down. He can concentrate on the race car. And, you know, of late, that's been a good thing. He's posted some really good finishes. Some may say that saved his job, and some just may say it's set him up for a better deal for next year. But he's got one.
It certainly didn't seem to break their concentration because they have been on a roll here in the final third of this season.
this is the same car that he finished third with at Kansas 3 weeks ago, second at Dover, sat on the pole and won the Winston Open in 2002. This has been a good race car for this type of racetrack.
In the last 11 races, Mayfield's five top 10 finishes have climbed him from 30th to 20th in the points, a gain of 10 spots.
29-20 on his first lap. He was green off into turn one and two. He looks like he's going to run his second lap. But now you see it's red. But it looks like he may be a little quicker on this lap than maybe he was his first lap if he can get off turn four. Looks like he lost a little bit in the middle of three and four, Jeff.
Actually, he picked up a little bit through there, Larry. I was watching the time before, and he was down to 177 mile an hour. He picked up just a little bit.
He picked up nearly two-tenths. Two-tenths from lap one to two, but it doesn't move him up from third on the board. Elliott Sadler, quickest so far. The NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series lives on speed, and they head for Phoenix next Friday, 5:30 p.m. Eastern Time. It's live, Duel in the Desert. And another tight points race.
Two races to go. Quite a dogfight between about four drivers over there.
Larry Foyt is back behind the wheel of AJ's number 14, the Harris Dodge.
There you see it right there, bottoming out in turn one. That's the big fear crew chief has when you go to qualify in a car you know is going to be quicker, especially driving off in the corner.
Put that little extra tape on there. The driver tries this a little bit harder. Especially with this cooler weather, the engine's probably purring a little bit stronger, pulling more horsepower. You bottom out when you go off in that corner.
Now going into three, he dipped the left front tire down onto the flat a bit. What does that do for the race car, Jeff?
A lot of times that de-wedges the car, and you got to be real careful right there when you do that. It can upset you quite a bit. Again, we see a lot of sparks out underneath that race car. That can't be very settling for the driver.
Well, yeah, we've talked about it before. Even if it don't upset the race car at over 190 miles per hour, it upsets the driver.
It breaks their concentration, and we talk about focus. Whenever they hear that thing bottoming out, they know something's wrong, and they're missing their marks.
He's only fourth out of four cars that's qualified on his first lap. This car's missed the last two shows, and he was only 46 quickest in practice, so he's going to be very borderline, Mike.
49 cars are here for Bud Pohl qualifying, so six will go home, Dave.
Second one to take the track tonight was Michael Waltrip. Michael, one lap only. Why?
Scared. That was all I had. I ran hard as I could on the first lap. The car stuck well, just a little bit too tight. We've been a little bit off today. We ran a 28.96 test and could never get the car to feel quite like that. Today's been a good day, though. We announced that Domino's Pizza is going to be an associate sponsor on our little Napa Chevy. So we had that going for us. The Aaron's Dream Machine that we'll race tomorrow is running well. And now I'm all qualified, and I'm going to do trackside on speed later tonight. So if you want to know everything that happened here at the Speedway, tune in.
And pizza for all his men. Matt?
And Chad Knaus's driver, Jimmy Johnson, 26 in practice. So what are your expectations for qualifying?
Be faster than 26th. We just didn't have the speed in practice. We've made some changes, looked at our teammate setups, and threw a new setup on this car, and we'll see what happens. But, you know, qualifying is very important, and last weekend, I think, showed that, you know, there is a lot on it, but it's not the end of the world. And you know, the big picture is we need points and keep thinking about you know, our points race that we have, and get in there, get a good starting spot if we can, and get things focused and turn around for Sunday if we don't end up picking it up right now. But this team kicks butt. We had a great finish last weekend, and looking forward to a good finish this weekend too.
First 1-2 finish for Jeff Gordon and Jimmy Johnson.
I hadn't realized that they had never done a 1-2 like that, but whoa!
You could see
slide.
Him bottom up, and it shot him all the way up the racetrack.
That is Jeff Green behind the wheel of the Cheerios Dodge of the Petties. This is the third different ride that Green has had this season. Started out in the AOL Chevy for 11 races, 12 in the Pennzoil Chevy, and this is his sixth race for the Petties.
You know, we talk about the speeds at the end of the straightaway. We're seeing 173, 174 miles per hour, and that's in the middle of the corner. That's the slowest part of the racetrack. Let's watch it right here in turn one and two. 173 miles per hour. Again, the slowest part of the racetrack.
So when Michael Waltrip says he's scared, Well, he's not being completely serious, but he's not completely kidding you either. You roll off into a corner like this at 190 miles an hour, and the back end starts to step sideways on you, and that will stop your heart.
It's kind of like driving right basically on a razor's edge. You never know which way you're going to go, on which side you're going to fall, and that's what these guys are faced with. When they go out and make these runs, they basically hold their breath, you know, for 30 seconds.
I've never seen a thrill ride that can compare, not even come close. Dave?
And Jeremy Mayfield may have had a thrill ride like that. Michael Waltrip sort of made the yaw signal to you there. Was that what your car was like?
Yeah, and y'all stands for y'all about to wreck. You know, if you're going to wreck, you keep on. But it was a little free, but overall it's good. We've just been good in practice, but we've just been a little too free on new tires. And, of course, you got to go on new tires here. So I didn't want to make my second lap, but it's faster. So, you know, thought we had all the first lap, but I never heard nothing on the radio to slow down. So I thought we better get all we can. And good thing we did. It was a little bit faster.
They didn't tell him to come in, so he took the second one, guys.
That's a good driver right there. If you don't call him off, he keeps on digging.
Keeps digging until he sees a checkered flag.
Exactly. That's right.
If Sam doesn't say we're in break, we just keep talking.
But you, that's our job.
But you knew that, didn't you, folks? Rusty Wallace in the Miller Lite Dodge. And look at the crowd around Jeff Burton. Trying to get out,
we say it all the time, Mike. Where can you go that these guys are getting ready to go and run over 200 miles an hour and are signing autographs just before they get inside the race car to do it?
There's nothing else like it.
They're special. They're a special breed.
Georgia Pacific Pole Night here at Atlanta. And Rusty Wallace will make his 43rd Atlanta start on Sunday. But he comes in here 14th in the standings versus 4th at this time last year.
You can see him in there with those white gloves. I mean, he has his hands full. You're fighting this race car because, again, this racetrack is very rough, very bumpy. You know, Rusty made his first Winston Cup start here in March of 1980, and I think that was driving for Roger Penske, top five finish that day.
You remember what he drove? Wasn't it the Impala?
Chevy, I believe it was the Chevrolet Impala.
That big old New York taxi cab style Impala. And it ran pretty well.
Rusty's first lap, 29.18. That's fourth quickest right now.
That's about 4/10 faster than he ran in practice, so he'd be pretty happy with that. I'll take that back. He's not on the pole, so he won't be real happy about it. It was a good pickup for him.
The thing that amazed me as I walked through the garage area this afternoon talking to some of the crew chiefs, some of the engine builders, he slows down about 1/10 of that from the second lap, is you used to come here, and to run fast, you somewhat pulled a fairly high gear. It took that high of a gear to run that fast where the RPMs wanted to be with the engine to make the most horsepower. Now these guys, they're turning these motors 92, 9300 here just like we do everywhere else.
So Rusty Wallace is fourth. Let's check with Matt.
A new track record in the Busch Series for Greg Biffle, but a 31-degree swing in temperature from the beginning of cup practice to the beginning of qualifying. How much more grip will we see out there?
You're going to see a lot more grip in the racetrack, and I tell you, my Granger Ford needs a lot more grip in the racetrack, but it hasn't been nearly as good as that Busch car has. I tell you, those guys over there in the Kleenex car, they've done a great job, and really excited about that car. Hope we can get this car here running a little bit better.
He was 25th fastest in practice, Mike.
Thanks, Matt. Derek Cope in his 2004 colors. He will run the entire Winston Cup season.
Derek needs to find a little bit of speed from practice. He was only 40th quickest. Derek's pretty excited about next year. He feels like that this company is stepping in and giving him the proper funding where he can step his program up, do a little testing, maybe get in the wind tunnel. All the things you have to do, not to win races, but just to be competitive in this Winston Cup Series.
Paramount Hospitality Management. They own hotels around the country. We're back in Derek Cope.
Such a fine line. I mean, on race day here on Sunday, you'll see these guys running in the middle of the racetrack, up at the top of the racetrack, there's three or four grooves. But tonight, the most grip is right there where you see Derek, right against that white line, the bottom of the racetrack through the corners. The quickest way around.
Derek's got a pretty good lap going right there, guys.
Fifth quickest to the 29-20.
It's a big pickup over practice right there for him.
Now, that's one of the few cars that wasn't considerably faster into turn one than it was going into turn three. Just about a 1 mile an hour difference. on that first lap. Here he's 2 miles an hour slower into turn three than he was the lap before.
Yeah, you can see him way up the racetrack. This definitely should not be quicker than his first lap. You really have to miss it on that first lap, and he slows down 4.5 tenths to run faster on that second lap.
Elliott Sadler, Michael Waltrip, Jeremy Mayfield, our quickest after seven cars. NASCAR Butt Bowl qualifying next week from Phoenix. You'll see it live at 4 p.m. Eastern Time next Friday from the Valley of the Sun.
A full weekend out there in Phoenix.
Wow.
NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series there, the Busch cars and the Winston Cup cars.
And Thursday night we'll be at the Fox Sports Cafe up in North Scottsdale as Dave Despain's guests on Wind Tunnel, so come on up and see us.
Are you sure we're the guest or are we the targets? Which is it?
You never know with Dave.
Entree of the night, I don't know.
Yeah.
Kenny Wallace in the 23 car. This is one of three Bill Davis entries, but boy, I'm telling you, all of the Bill Davis cars struggling. Kenny was only 45th quickest in practice, and then his teammate Scott Wimmer and Shelby Howard, they were slower than he was.
Big difference from last week. Last week at Martinsville, they were just at the top of the list.
Yep. Second and fourth. Yep.
Very impressive run right there.
Sixth quickest, 29-27.
And let's see, I think it's about 100 miles an hour difference, too, from Martinsville to this week.
Just about.
Almost.
Same car that Kenny ran at Lowe's Motor Speedway a couple of weeks ago, and he actually qualified pretty well there on qualifying night. Pretty decent qualifying run, but they have been struggling here all afternoon.
I know there's a difference in sound between cars with headers with pipes that exit out the left and exit out the right. That just didn't sound right.
Didn't sound crisp.
No. Sixth fastest for Kenny. Let's meet the eldest of the Racing Wallace brothers.
And he ran a 29-18. Rusty, tell us about your lap and also what the track's like right now.
The track's in really good shape right now. I mean, it's got a lot of grip. It's cooled down about 25 degrees, the track surface has. I was really, really loose in practice, and we sat down with the team and changed left side air pressures, nose weight, some wedge, some different things. I was bottoming out real hard in practice, and it was the side skirts. We cut those up. And be quite honest, I had a hell of a car in qualifying. If I'd have known the car had been that good, I wouldn't I think I left about a 10th lane and turned the exit of turn two. But other than that, I think I killed three and four pretty good. But it's a good car. I just was so far behind in practice, man. We were changing everything, get going.
All right, let's go up to the front of the grid. Matt Yoakum.
From the oldest Wallace to the youngest Bodine, six fastest in practice. You matted it all the way in your qualifying lap for the Busch car. What about this car?
I don't think so. National Guard Ford's pretty good, but I don't want to test the waters that good. But the Cup cars entered the corner so much faster. It's almost, I won't say impossible, because my big brother did it when he set the track record. He run around here wide open, but we also had new pavement. But it's almost impossible to run wide open. And I say that, and I bet you Rocket Ryan's going to try it for sure. He's got a good race car. But the National Guard Ford was really good, fifth fastest. I think we just need to go out and get a good, solid lap. You know, we don't need to try for the pole. We just need to get a good top 10 starting spot. Crew's done a great job. This is a brand new body on this car, new car, and it's really running good.
Ward Burton, after 272 starts for Bill Davis in the number 22 and five victories, he moves over to the Net Zero High Speed Internet Access Pontiac, which he will drive in 2004.
First lap, seventh quickest of a 29-28. They were 23rd quickest in practice. They tested down here. You know, coming to Atlanta with Tony Furr as your crew chief, you'd have a little bit of confidence. Won a race here with Jerry Nadeau, but like he told me, he said, Larry, we should have won three or four races. Ran out of fuel on the last lap one time, so Tony's pretty impressed with Ward so far, and just like I've told a lot of people, just the newness with the new driver, the new crew chief, everything, that right there could pick this race team up just immediately.
You're exactly right when you say that, Larry, because got a chance to talk to Tony just before they put the car through inspection today. He said, I'm really excited about this particular car because when they came to Atlanta, they got a chance to test. They worked strictly on race setup, and he said the car was really good in long runs. And as you know, a lot of times tires have a tendency to drop off here, so you got to have a really good setup that allows you to run the bottom or the top, and they feel like they've got a good package for Sunday.
And Ward will be one of our guests on Trackside, which you'll see tonight immediately following Winston Cup Bud Pole qualifying. It's Award, seventh of nine. There are 49 cars here. That means that six will not start the Bass Pro Shops MBNA 500 on Sunday. Let's see, who's on trackside tonight as Billy Bigley takes to the track.
We got Ford Burton, we've already said that. He's going to be there for us. Bobby Hamilton Jr. is supposed to be coming by, last week's winner from Memphis.
Scott Wimmer.
Jason Jarrett.
You never know who will wander by.
We even heard Mr. Wind Tunnel himself may drop by, Dave Despain.
Really?
That's what the word on the street is.
That's big.
We get our shot at him.
Yeah, right, before next Thursday night. Billy Bigley is a graduate of what you may remember as the All-Pro Series. Still trying to qualify for his first Winston Cup race. Missed the field at Indy, Richmond, and Dover, along with Bristol. He's from Naples, Florida.
Sounds can be deceiving. It just sounds like he's off the throttle an awfully long time back there in 1 and 2. Saw Mike Hillman, who was Brett Bodine's crew chief, working with this group today. Of course, Bobby Allison is on board as a consultant with this race team. Good to see Bobby in the garage area again.
Billy, for many years, was a contender in what is now the Kodak Southeast Series of NASCAR.
It's going to be a push right there, yep. 30-15. You're definitely going to have to be probably in the mid to low 29s to be safe by any stretch.
And, right. he's on the go or go home plan. That car is so low in owner's points, he has to make it on time.
And like we said earlier, Larry, sometimes it's really hard to make that jump being a really good short track racer to some of these super speedways that you've got in the heavier cars and what you feel with these radial tires.
Picks up on his second lap, but not near enough, 30.04. So right now he's 10th out of 10 cars that has qualified.
And here's Matt.
And Jeff, you've talked a lot about chemistry and drivers switching teams, and Booty Barker, then Chris Rice, now Frankie Stoddard. You've had a lot of guys to work with in the last year.
Yeah, quite a few crew chiefs, but you know, Frankie and the guys have done a great job on a Caterpillar car today. We just we're a little bit off. We're struggling quite a bit in qualifying trim. Hopefully we hit something here, and otherwise we'll just get ready for the race.
47 fastest in practice, a lot of changes made. He did qualify 15th for tomorrow's Busch Series race, Mike.
Thanks, Matt. 10 drivers on track so far, and there's no rush to send cars out tonight. It's beautiful weather. Got a beautiful night out there, so we're not seeing the cars moving out there one right after another as we do on some afternoons. Jimmy Johnson and the Lowe's Chevrolet, two poles this season. June Pocono in Kansas, three wins, Lowe's Motor Speedway, and both Loudon races. Finished second last week at Martinsville to his boss, if you will, Jeff Gordon, who co-owns this number 48 Chevy, along with Rick Henry.
This place has not been good to Jimmy Johnson in the 48 car, though. This is his fifth start. He's only had one top 10 finish, and he finished outside the top 20 the other three times, and only one top 10 start, and that was second a year ago when qualifying was rained out.
Well, as he said earlier, he made a lot of changes in this race car, and going back to what you were talking about, Larry, yeah, last year he finished 22nd here at this particular track, and if he expects to try to win that point championship, he's about to do better than that on Sunday. Good starting position would be a really good thing to do here right now.
I'll tell you what, she's looking pretty good right here. There you see our green bubble. Looks like they've definitely made this car better.
Listen to this thing as it goes by.
You tell she's making some horsepower. Second quickest on that first lap, 28.91.
I know there's differences in exhaust systems, but that thing sounds more like an Indy car than a stock car.
Carrying a lot of RPM. It never loses any RPMs, Mike, the way it's looking right now. You did see it bottom out just a little bit as it went into turn one right there. It definitely is up on that chip, as you want to say, Larry.
Yeah, I don't think this lap will be as good. You know, we've been following this. Jimmy Johnson has been in the top 10 in Winston Cup points for 65 straight races. I was curious what the record is. The record is 174 races by Dale Earnhardt. That's seven seasons in the top 10 in points straight.
Pretty impressive. So is Jimmy Johnson. He is second fastest to Elliott Sadler so far. What's that big whooshing sound? It's the wind tunnel, and it fires up again Monday night through Thursday at 9 p.m. Dave Despain's guests are the greatest names in motorsports and clunkers like us. Jeff and Larry and I'll be on there on Thursday night. You can throw us your high hard one about NASCAR on Fox or the sport of NASCAR racing.
If we don't know the answer, we'll make one up.
You weren't supposed to tell them that.
Shh, trade secrets. Greg Biffle in the Granger Ford. Finished right where he started last week, 19th in Martinsville. One of the few drivers who has not used a provisional in 2003.
And that's as a rookie, which is pretty phenomenal.
Had one DNQ, and that was Las Vegas. Did not qualify. That's a DNQ.
Greg, seventh quickest on his first lap at a 29.27. He was 25th quickest in practice. Greg's going to really have to step it up these final four races, and Jamie McMurray's going to have problems because Jamie seems to have a lock on this Robestus Rookie of the Year points battle.
Yeah, I guess it's mostly on points now. It's no longer as subjective as that. No grip, Greg says. Competition used to be because with a win, especially a big win in the Pepsi 400.
That's the best lap we've run all day. That's seventh right now out of 12.
Well, Greg said the track would really tighten up, and for him, it did not. Matt?
Kevin Harvick on the front row for the Busch Series race, ninth in practice. Kevin, what number are you shooting for?
I think you're going to have to run about a 28.60 or so, maybe even a little bit better than that to beat the Ryan Newman number. So the GM Goodrich Chevrolet was really good in practice. We had a really good lap and just bottomed out in 3 and 4 and shot us up the track. So hopefully the car works just like it did and we can keep it from hitting the ground.
And the temperature is beginning to drop even more, Dave.
Jimmy Johnson with the 91. You happy with that, or do you think there's a little bit more out there for you?
Well, for us, that's a huge pickup. I don't know how much everybody else will pick up, but we changed the car completely and actually headed more towards what our teammate Brian Vickers had in his car for his setup. And I was talking to Chad before I rolled off. I said, what should I worry about with this setup? And he said, nothing. We got a good backup car. So I got back on the radio and said, all right, but I'm going to be committed. And I stuck it into one and didn't really let off all that much. Kept it down, and it was good, and I knew we were going to have a good lap. But wherever that ends up, you know, we're showing forward progress. The practice this morning wasn't so good for us, and this team just never quits. This Lowe's team rocks, and we'll be good on Sunday.
Your teammate Jeff just walked by. Did you give him any advice about the track?
He's trying to find out what the track was like, but you know, we changed so much, it's hard to tell him anything besides just stand on it, because I know I didn't let off much.
All right, and if he does that, guys, might be a typical Jeff Gordon qualifying run.
You know, I was going to say, I think he's been watching that Days of Thunder movie. Just trust me, put it on the outside, it'll stick.
Well, you talk about a positive mental attitude, and there's Jimmy Johnson. The guy, he's always got a quip and a smile, and there's a fellow who's definitely a budding superstar in this business. Todd Bodine in the National Guard Ford, second fastest. Big number on the board for Bodine.
That is a good run. Of course, as you heard him say, they'd been fifth in practice. This race team, I think we talked about this last couple of weeks, and he's one and done. They just continue to gain momentum here in the latter part of this season. There you see Jimmy Johnson now talking to his other teammate, Brian Vickers.
What a lap for Todd.
Yeah, Brian was second quickest in practice earlier.
The youngest of the Bodine brothers, as he said at the top of the show, his oldest brother, Jeffrey, holds the track record here at a phenomenal 195 and change, set when the track had just been repaved. 197 and change. Matt?
And what does Tony Stewart have in common with past presidents and the late Dale Earnhardt? You had a big week in Washington, didn't you?
Yeah, we got to speak to a lot of press people that were live in there on TV. So it was a pretty big honor to do the National Press Club's luncheon this week.
And this is your home track due to Home Depot being here in Atlanta. A big track for you. You've won here before. What about your shot for the pole?
Well, I don't know if we're going to run an 80, but I think we ran a 20 in practice. And I told Dippy I knew I left something on the table. We went from being a little bit loose in the practice session to a little bit tight. And this is one of those tracks that if you're off a little bit, it shows up a lot on the stopwatch. So, you know, if I do my job and run the car the way it's supposed to be driven, I think we got a shot at getting up there maybe in the top 5 or 6 maybe. But that'd still be better in practice. I think we were 17th in practice. So if we can get in the top 5 or 6, that'd be great.
And this team has really been on a roll, Mike, knocking down a bunch of top 5 finishes.
Thanks, Matt. There are a number of good cars without drivers next year, and there's one of them, the Pennzoil number one of Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. There are a number of good drivers without rides for next season, and John Andretti is one of them. Together, they put together a first lap that is fourth fastest.
And he had been quick in practice, 10th quickest, so they're kind of backing up their practice lap. He's going to try to run a second lap here.
This, however, is a team that is sponsor hunting for 2004.
He slows down about a tenth and a half, which we're seeing pretty consistently on that, but right now, John's fourth quickest.
And here's Dave with a man that is second fastest.
And we were actually monitoring Todd's radio and pushing off both corners and still that fast?
Yeah, I had to lift off a four. That's how bad it was. I can't believe it. Hadn't done that all day. But still posted a decent time. Hopefully that'll be top 10. National Guard team done a great job. This is a really good car. We know it races well. We've run it Kansas City and Charlotte. It raced well. So hopefully we'll have a good day Sunday. I got to interview before and I didn't say hi to Ashlyn and Lynn at home. Hi, baby.
Now, you were thinking pole then going out, weren't you?
Well, I didn't want to say that, you know, but Rocket Ryan's got to go yet. So we'll see what the pole is going to be. I'm guessing about a 42 is what Ryan's going to run.
All right. Great run for Todd.
Yeah, Roger Clemens isn't the only Rocket on TV this week.
Yeah, baseball's got theirs and NASCAR's got Ryan Newman. He definitely can get the job done. There he goes, one of the youngest drivers here this weekend, Shelby Howard in the third Bill Davis car, number 27.
Third place in the ARCA points. Three wins in 22 ARCA races, 10 top fives. 18 years old from Greenwood, Indiana.
Finished second in the ARCA race back here in March. Really going to have to step it up. Sounds like he's off the throttle a lot through three and four right here. This is coming to take the green, which will hurt that whole front straightaway, but he was only 49 quickest out of 49 cars. This deal kind of came together late. How this deal came together is when Ward Burton stepped out of the 22 car and Scott Wimmer stepped in there. This was the car that Scott Wimmer was going to race here. He actually tested this car here a couple weeks ago.
I think we need to point out that this actually is a Chevrolet while Scott Wimmer is driving a Dodge. Bill Davis has got several different types of cars in his shop right now.
And the rumor has it that Shelby Howard will be affiliated with Bill Davis Racing next year in some shape, form, or fashion.
Can you say tailgate?
I can't say nothing.
Well, maybe next week. All right, Shelby Howard, 15th of 15. On his first lap, he's going to play two.
I'm pretty sure this would be a go or go home, right?
Yeah, he's fourth from the bottom of owner's points, and that's how the provisional starts are determined. So since he is that far down the list, there's no way he would qualify for a provisional.
Yeah, I think this car has only ran two Winston Cup races earlier in the year with Scott Wimmer behind the wheel. See, he slows down quite a bit on that second lap, so I'm not sure if we'll see Shelby Howard in the race on Sunday.
And keep in mind, all three of the Davis cars were well down the speed chart, so that run's probably not indicative of that young fella's talent. This young fella's talent was evident in practice. Brian Vickers, the man on the right, you know the guy on the left, but the fella on the right, oh boy, did he cause a couple of gray hairs in practice with the speed he put on the board. Second fastest to the Rocket. Dave?
And, Mike, his words to me were, I haven't seen you guys in a long time. Now, you didn't equal your pole of 98 here, but pretty good lap, huh?
I wish I would have run as quick as I did in 98, but I think the track had a little more grip then. But the Pennzoil Chevy was really good, and the guys have done a great job. I've been struggling a little bit in qualifying, but last week in Martinsville, we had a just killer car in the race. So we had this thing anywhere close that we had last week would be good. But I went to talk to you in the last week, but kept ripping left our tires off.
Yeah, that'll happen. That'll knock down your finishing position, Mike.
Thanks, Dave. Here is Scott Wimmer, who this week steps into the Bill Davis Cat Dodge, replacing Ward Burton, who was moved on for 2004 and just a bit early at that. Six Winston Cup starts, made his first start right here in November of 2000, finished 22nd. He is seventh in the Busch Series standings.
Like I say, you documented a while ago, and we've been talking, all the Bill Davis cars somewhat struggling. Right now, Scott's going to be 13th quickest. He was 47th quickest in practice.
Yeah, his 29.45 is about 2/10 slower than his teammate Kenny Wallace. But so he could be a little better on this lap.
Just sounds like he's off the throttle quite a bit in the middle of the corner, like we've talked about a lot of these cars. And that just a little bit can make such a difference at these speeds.
That's it. Larry falls off 3/10, and most of it up there in turns 3 and 4. Elliott Sadler may be surprised to find himself quickest so far, but that's how we stand after 16 cars. Of 49 drivers have had their turn at the track at Atlanta Motor Speedway. Jeff Burton in the Citgo Ford. He will be back in this car next year. They are hunting a primary sponsor for this Ross Larson Ford. One top 10 start here came in the spring race of 98. He's had 6 top 10 starts this season, 7th twice.
Had a good top 10 finish at Martinsville last week, but struggled in practice today, only 43rd quickest. Don't think they're going to be very happy with this lap right here.
That sounds more like a trombone than a trumpet going by. And he is 14th of 17 at a 29.57. That's about 7/10 off of Elliott Sadler's pole.
So he just about bought the wall right there at that time.
And that'll do it for Jeff Burton out of South Boston, Virginia. 14th of 17. Matt?
New colors for Joe Nemechek. Now you're battling some kind of flu bug. I know a pole would really make you feel better. What about it?
I think we got a pretty good shot, you know, hopefully getting the top 10. This whole U.S. Army team, Pontiac, these guys working really hard. It's kind of our first. We went and tested at Phoenix this week and learned a little bit, but coming to Atlanta, place is really, really fast. They've run good with Mike Skinner, and we had to tweak on their cars a little bit to get them comfortable for me, but I think we can get up there in the top 10. At least that's what I'm shooting for.
He's always qualified well here. In fact, Mike, one pole, and he's never taken a provisional here at Atlanta.
He'll be up a little later on. Kevin Harvick, the point standing runner-up. GM Goodwrench Chevy comes out front row. He was on the pole for the Busch race through the entire session. He was set the second car to go on the track, and he held the pole until the final driver snatched it away.
It's looking pretty good right here halfway down the back stretch. It's real close to Elliott Sadler's pole speed, but right there turning off into turn 3. You just saw the little ball, flipped to red. But he lost a lot. It sounded like he had to get completely out of the throttle off turn 4, and he's going to be 4th quickest. That's where he lost all of his time. We've heard so many drivers talk about that. He's going to be one and done. You're just carrying so much speed, you run out of racetrack there.
It's hard to reconcile that you can be completely out of the throttle and slow down to 183. That's your slowdown speed.
Who could ever forget this right here, though?
Oh,
March of 2001. Only his 3rd start in that Goodwrench car, and what a finish right here. How about that?
Look at how close that was.
A lot of excitement right there with that team that day. A lot of emotion.
And here's Matt.
And Jeff Gordon, you had a chance to talk to Jimmy Johnson, the guy that you own his car. What did he tell you? How close are you two?
You know, we haven't really been the same today for whatever reason. You know, he was tired, I was loose. And he said the track had a ton of grip. So I'm just hoping that what we did is far enough and that we can utilize the grip of the racetrack for it to make a good lap. This is the car we qualified 2nd with in Charlotte. So it's a fast car, motor's running great. We should be able to put a good lap. So just this is one of those tracks you just drive it down the first corner and hold your breath and try not to lift. And if it sticks, you're going to have a good one.
How impressed have you been by Brian Vickers?
Extremely impressed. I got a test with him in Phoenix this week, and he seriously impressed me. He was faster than we were and got in my car, went faster than me in my car. So he was very impressive and certainly doing a great job here today.
Tony Stewart's hopes for a top 5 were dashed on that lap, 10th quickest, but he's green light coming through turn 2. Didn't carry quite enough speed off of 2.
And he knew it. He knew he was not very good off turn 2, had to get out of the throttle. He said, might as well end this lap.
So Stewart's 29.22 will be 10th fastest right now.
Well, what a roll this group has been on here lately. 5 straight top 5 finishes, including that win at Lowe's a couple of weeks ago. They're just going to run out of races, though. There are not enough races to get where they need to get in the points.
During that stretch, he gained 317 points on Matt Kenseth, but just too much to overcome. Dave?
And Kevin explaining to his crew, tell us, you pick up more than a tenth, but are you happy with that?
Not with myself. I just I didn't get to the green flag like I should have. I just let up a little bit too much, and one and two, I just let up a little bit too much. So it other than that, Jim Goodwin Chevrolet drove really good, and that should get us a decent spot.
It is difficult not to let up, isn't it?
Well, I tell you, the most difficult part is probably getting out of the Busch car and getting into this thing, and we just went through happy hour, and you're driving about 2.5 seconds slower, so pretty big adjustment.
All right, guys, it is a big difference between these two cars.
Seems to be. Tony Raines driving Bill Bumgarner's number 74 Chevy. And silly season rumors have included the former ASA champ for next year, for perhaps one of those good cars that still remains open. But I like what Bill Bumgarner has done with this team since bringing it up from the Busch Series to Winston Cup. They've run all the races, and without a full-time sponsor, they've done extremely well.
They've only missed one race, as Tony's going to be 14th quickest. Brand-new race car, no test, as you see him really bottoming out, not only coming off turn four, but going into turn one. Didn't get to the wind tunnel like a lot of teams would do with a new race car. In fact, they worked night and day the last few days just to get this race car here.
But what's really amazed me about Tony Raines is that no matter what kind of situation you put him in, he seemed like he's been able to pick up the pace when it comes time as far as qualifying to do a really good job for this team.
Second lap mirrors the first, and Raines will stand 14th of 20. We are closing in on halfway in butt pole qualifying. Speedway, where it's Georgia Pacific pole night, and Sterling Marlin, the Coors Light Dodge. Happy Halloween, everybody.
What that is on the hood, Mike, that's the St. Jude Halloween pinup program. It's a program which Coors Light has got involved with their distributors and their retail accounts, and it's allowed customers to purchase a paper pumpkin cutout, and all the proceeds are donated directly to the St. Jude's Research Hospital over in Memphis, Tennessee. Neat, neat program.
Great cause.
Or Sterling did not race here a year ago. He was injured, but they have struggled here of late. Their last 12 races this season, no top 10 finishes, and Sterling still hunting that first top five finish.
Well, his woes continue right now, Larry. He winds up 17th after running that first lap, and it looks like he's going to try to maybe pick it up some on his second lap, see what he can do.
Made his 600th start last week, but got his 8th DNF of 2003. That's three times in the last four races that Marlin's failed to finish.
Yeah, they were only 39th quickest in practice. I talked to Tony Glover, the team manager, and he said, Larry, we just don't know what we're missing on this race car right now. And he slows down about a tenth on his second lap.
And, folks, he's 17th out of 21, but the difference between Marlin and the pole is 7/10 of a second, which is a couple of finger snaps. It's not that big a difference, but it's well down the chart. Matt, did you bring your alarm clock?
I nudged Kenny Schrader, woke him up. He's wiping the sleep out of his eyes. This team really continues to gain week in and week out, don't they, Kenny?
We're gaining, aren't we? You know, we had a good run last week. Need to get a good qualifying effort tonight. Hopefully Bob up there, you know, got him on the hood of the car with the promotion that 1-800-CALL-ATT did for this race. Have him up there instead of Carrot Top today. So hopefully we're getting ready to go scare the heck out of him.
Now, people may ask, how can you fall asleep in a race car? But it's pretty comfortable in there, isn't it?
Oh, man, these are just nice, comfortable cars. And, you know, I'm sitting in my office. This is a relaxing place to be. Instead of standing around there walking around, I said, heck, I just get in the car. And a lot of times I sit down, I fall asleep. But pretty good napping in here.
I'll bring him a little milk toast or something. And
well, I hate to tell Kenny this, but Sleeping Beauty, he's not.
All right, new driver for the Army team. Joe Nemechek climbs aboard. Jerry Nadeau injured. Mike Wallace was in for a while.
If he can get back
Mike
here,
Skinner.
Back
there. Green light. Front row. Joe.
Lost a little bit off turn four. This still going to be much better than he was in practice. Third quickest for Joe Nemechek.
28.90. You know, Jerry Nadeau especially, as we got green light again at turn two. Looks like he's going to play two. And Mike Skinner and now Joe have all qualified really well with this car.
Yeah, I mean, this team has two poles this year, and that's with two different drivers, Mike Skinner at Richmond and Boris Said back at Infineon back in June on the road course.
And our best wishes continue to go out to Jerry Nadeau as he continues his recovery. Looks like it's going to be a little lengthier than was hoped by this team, so they have picked up Joe Nemechek from the Hendrick organization to drive the rest of this season and next season.
There's that same group again. Now they have found Bill Elliott.
Well, I'm surprised the crowd around Bill is that small, because he is the hometown hero here in Atlanta. From Dawsonville, just about a half hour's ride up to the northeast of the city.
Made an announcement here this week that he's going to join forces with a company in Georgia with a food line of food group.
He's going to become the Jimmy Dean of racing.
That's it. Beef jerky and hot sauces. And
I don't know. Bill Elliott pure pork sausage just doesn't roll off my tongue just yet. But maybe when we try some.
Well, I was going to say, a guy he used to drive for right now is doing pretty good with it, and that's Junior Johnson. He's got his own little ham company
and
pork rinds. You know, these country boys, they know how to survive.
Roy Buckshot Jones at his home racetrack here in Atlanta. The folks at Aaron's
hang on.
Boy, he almost had to rent himself another one right there.
And that's one of the things these guys fought in practice, was bottoming out. And I know they were working on that. Of course, this car is owned by Michael Walter. It's a car that's leased from Dale Earnhardt Incorporated with a Dale Earnhardt Incorporated engine. But you can just see he's got his hands full in this race car.
And he's got to go, Larry. They have no owner points. It's go or go home for Buckshot.
And that's going to be awfully borderline. Maybe he can adapt on his second lap as he's 21st quickest. There you see the car still bottoming out. Right here is where he had his hands full. Looked a little better through there that time, Jeff.
He picked up a little bit of speed right there. He needs to pick up some more, though.
If he gets through three and four, I think this will definitely be a better lap than that first lap.
He can pick up five positions right here.
Right there, you saw the bottom out in turn four. The car got real loose right there. Lost a lot of time.
Gain of two on the second lap. Gain of 2/10 and two positions.
And with 49 cars here, you have to beat at least 13 cars to guarantee yourself a spot in that fastest 36.
And Larry, I hate to say it, but I think if they could have kept that car off the racetrack, he definitely had an excellent chance of doing that.
And I know, as I said, I talked to Bobby Kennedy, the crew chief on his car. They were fighting that in practice.
Here's Dave with second row Joe.
Yeah, and it was going to be hard to resist the new nickname for the guy driving the Army car, G.I. Joe. But, you know, now with this guy in there, Joe, it's going to be even harder. That was actually your G.I. Joe, isn't it?
It is. It's my G.I. Joe back from when I was probably 5 or 6 years old. So Mom found it somewhere, and she brought it and tied it in the car. Great effort for the whole U.S. Army Pontiac team. Brian Pemberton, these guys, they believe me, they're working really hard. I'm proud to be driving this thing.
Joe showed him he's still got it, guys.
Mike, it just goes to show, he's no regular Joe for sure.
G.I. Joe, I'll bet there's a marketing tie-in there somewhere. Jeff Gordon.
He had his hands full right there coming off that curve.
He was eighth quickest in practice. Looks like that's about where he's at, headed off into turn three.
Last week, got his 15th career win from the pole, his 63rd Winston Cup victory. To be ninth with a 29-10.
Boy, he has been on the mark in qualifying this year. 32 races, 23 top 10 starts. I think he's had enough of this.
Let me tell you why, too. When he got down in the middle of three and four, that car just started at the racetrack on him. He just about couldn't keep it up off the wall right there.
I did until it got to the end.
So Jeff Gordon times in ninth. Elliott Sadler and Todd Bodine, two Fords, are fastest so far. Welcome back to Atlanta. This car will put us halfway through Bud Pole qualifying for the Bass Pro Shops MBNA 500. Kevin LePage will drive the rest of this season for Larry McClure in the Kodak number four. The Shelburne, Vermont driver qualified in the top five at Michigan and at Lowe's. Has one pole in 135 starts, and it came here in 1999.
Looks like a pretty good lap
he
for
Kevin. He does. Carla really looks good. Tim Brewer is over there working with Kevin Page, veteran crew chief of many years. Starting to get it together, looks like.
It's going to be a good run. Seventh quickest for Kevin. You mentioned that top five qualifying at Lowe's a couple of weeks ago. This is the same car he did this with. Good race car for these guys.
Green light down into one and out of two. Lost a little time coming off the corner, but and that'll be that.
And he knew it.
Yep.
That's a good run, though, for those boys.
That's all I can stand. I can't stand no more.
Matt?
And a lot of debate down here. Now, what did you just tell your driver, Bill Elliott?
I'm not really telling him anything. I'm trying to get him to sponsor my Busch car at Rockingham with his new Bill Elliott pork rinds. But he wants to know how much a sticker costs. We can talk.
See, I want to know what a sticker maybe under the rear bumper or something would cost me. You know, a bag of pork rinds, beef jerky, whatever it takes.
I say about $3.6
million. ain't on our budget yet.
What did he just tell you about holding it all the way to the mat, all the way around?
Well, I started to pull my suit off and give it to him.
He said to hold it wide open, and I could probably get partway in that corner before I ran out of talent, so I'd let him handle it.
Five pulls here, Bill. What about your shot for a sixth?
Well, I think the guy about three cars up is going to be the guy to beat. I mean, we were okay in practice, but it's just going to depend on what the track changed and, you know, how good we guess at what we've got.
Okay, we'll report back later about the pork rind deal between Ray and Bill.
All right, stay tuned. Kenny Schrader, 1-800-CALL-ATT-DODGE. And that is not Carrot Top on the hood. It's a fan who won a contest.
Thank goodness.
Robert Underwood of South Elgin, Illinois, and how he won that was every collect phone call that was made in the month of August through about the end of September entered you to be a part of this promotion here. As you get on the hood, you get to come enjoy the race this week.
Do you win the hood? That would be appropriate.
I would think so.
I do too. We'll lobby for that.
I think that should
see
happen.
If we can help Robert out here.
Kenny on his first lap is going to be 20th quickest. He looks like he's going to go for this second lap. He was 38th quickest in practice, so they picked their car up quite a bit.
Definitely so. Car looked pretty good. Just losing just a little bit like we've seen all night long. Right in the middle of that corner where you want to keep it down. The guys are having to run up the racetrack just a little bit.
Only fell off about 5/100ths to his second lap, so not a bad run for Schrader, who I thought Kenny'd won a pole here. Apparently not. His best start here, outside pole for Rick Hendrick in 89 in this race.
He did win a race here once.
That's it. Yes, he did. In 91, he won the spring race.
Larry, I got a question for you. First time we've qualified under the lights here in Atlanta. You know how it gets sometimes in a late fall, that once the sun goes down, you start getting that kind of like a dampness, a dew falling out of the air. I wonder if it's having an effect on this racetrack right now. You know, a lot like what heat would do this time, the moisture, I wonder if it's affecting the grip of the race car.
Boy, it's had an effect on Dale Jarrett's paint job. It's all different.
Yeah, what this is the UPS store paint scheme. Of course, Atlanta's the home for UPS, but I agree, Jeff. I would be a little nervous. You always want a late qualifying draw when the track temperature really goes down. But I think if these cars are a little bit looser to begin this qualifying session, if there indeed is a lot of moisture in there, and there should be this time of year, it definitely could actually take grip away from the race car.
Since this track was reconfigured into a quad oval and the backstretch became the front stretch in November 97, Dale Jarrett scored more points here than any other driver.
You know, Elliott Sadler's on the pole right now, Dale Jarrett's teammate. It looks like Dale Jarrett's going to be one done. Just real quickly, we didn't get to talk about this last week at Martinsville, but James Luter, a machinist for Robert Yates Racing, passed away last week. He had been a machinist. He worked with Bill France Sr. back when he used to race the motorcycles, and they used to have an all-pro team.
That's right.
And James Luter was the all-pro machinist for that the entire time they had it, about 10 or 12 years. So, again, our well wishes go out to the James Luter family.
What was it you said? If you could dream it, he could make it.
Yes, sir. He could take a lathe and make a lathe.
Right. So Dale Jarrett is 17th out of 27 so far.
We'll find out how much the grip the racetrack has now.
Yeah.
There he is.
Light up the rocket.
Getting ready to say, ready for your countdown. 10, 9. This cat here, he can definitely get it done.
Purdue University Boilermaker Ryan Newman in the Mobile One Speed Pass Dodge.
Again, pay attention now. He's coming to this start-finish line right now to take the green. This car is wound up. I mean, it is on kill right now.
Which is a big key to running this fast lap here. This is the same car that he sat on the pole with a couple of weeks at Lowe's Motor Speedway.
199 miles per hour into turn one, and that's just after taking the green.
That's the fastest I've seen so far tonight. That was the fastest through turning one and two.
And look at this. The green bubble continues to move further away from the center. If he gets through three and four, this is going to be an awesome lap for this team.
182 through three and four. That's the lowest speed right there.
191 at the line, and by three full tenths of a second, Ryan Newman blows away Elliott Sadler for the pole.
Over 194 miles per hour, and again, that's a mile-and-a-half racetrack.
Do I hear blast-off, guys?
28:53.
He's even amazed. That's right. Matt Boylan, yes. His crew.
He's sitting there shaking his head. I can't believe he did it.
That is the fastest qualifying lap turned in this entire Winston Cup season.
There it is.
Good grief.
But don't be surprised, guys. Every time this young man's qualified here in Atlanta, he's either been on the pole or outside pole. He's only qualified here twice in his career, but he's always been up there at the front.
I am still wondering, how can that car be that fast and still have that alleged smaller carburetor that gives them better mileage? How do you do both of those?
I ain't going there. We're talking qualifying right
okay.
now.
Okay.
But speaking of qualifying, here's the man that was second quickest in practice, Brian Vickers, in the car for the final four races this 2003 season that he'll be with all next year. Yeah, I think he about talked to every driver that he came to as he was walking toward his car.
Turned 20 years old. Just turned 20 years old.
Pretty good lap, guys. There you see it. So far, good and solid. Second place. It's going to be a great run for Brian Vickers. Second quickest. So he backs up what he did in practice.
28:68. That's almost two-tenths faster than Sadler.
It's kind of like I'm the real deal. Real deal. Now let's slow it on down here, Brian.
That's a subtle way of saying that's enough.
That's a great
lap. 28:68. Awesome.
Almost. Let's meet the man who's fastest.
And we'll ask him, first of all, do you realize that is the quickest lap in NASCAR Winston Cup racing this year on any track?
Yeah, it's pretty quick. The automobile one, Dodge unloaded good, Matt, and the guys did an awesome job. Got to thank everybody back at the shop. Obviously, Penske Engines takes a lot of horsepower to get around this place, but hopefully it'll stand up. It was a good lap for us. Car wasn't perfect balance-wise, but felt pretty good.
And you heard the joy in that Borland's voice when he radioed back to you, right?
Yeah, I actually thought it might have been just a tick quicker, but still 53 is pretty darn good.
All right, these guys love doing well for each other. Great car, great drive. Matt?
Kurt Busch wanted to wait until Ryan Newman went out. He ran a 28:53. Now what are you going to shoot for, Kurt?
In the movie Spaceballs, there's a couple different speeds that they run their spaceships, and that was ludicrous speed. That was out of control. It's great to watch him some days, and it's great to be in competition with him to try to beat him, but we're just going to go try to make a lap with our rubbermaid brute Ford and see what we can get. I mean, that's just way too fast. We'll shoot for the low 80s or something like that, maybe be in the top five, I hope.
And the bad news for the competition, since the end of July, that 12 team has not gone three races in a row without a win. Guess what Sunday will be without a win?
Three races. Casey Mears, who's also running the Busch race and had a good lap there. He is 12th on his first lap, 29:07. You got to love the comic genius of Mel Brooks.
Oh, yeah.
Who created Spaceballs with Rick Moranis and cast of thousands. Ludicrous speed was one great line. The other was when Yogurt, the takeoff on Yoda from Star Wars, says, "What you want to know the secret of the universe?" And Mel Brooks pulls back the curtain. Merchandising. Spaceballs, the lunchbox. Spaceballs looked like Action Performance back there. All right, Casey Mears, second lap, better than the first.
Picks
and he winds up 11th.
Picks up a couple of spots.
Ryan Newman is quickest. And Brian Vickers had a heck of a lap, and they share a laugh about it. Thirty drivers have taken time. None more awaited by the crowd than this man. Bill Elliott is legend. He's been racing here since 1976. Ran off nine straight top five starts, including three poles. And now he
he's in the top 10 in Winston Cup points for, I think, the first time this season.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Green light.
See the paint scheme on this car? This is part of that 1988 championship paint scheme of the Victory Lap Tribute Program by Winston. What a fitting place for Bill Elliott to run this paint scheme.
Car's bottoming out just a little bit through the corner. It's making him probably run up that racetrack just a little bit, but he's definitely not getting out of the throttle.
He stayed in it because it's going to be a good run for Bill. Third quickest.
I'll get this crowd excited for sure.
Ray's probably still glad he left Bill in this car for the qualifying run.
The last two races, they had time trials here at Atlanta. Elliott qualified on the pole in the spring of 2002 and the outside pole this spring.
This chassis, all three wins that Bill has had for Ray Everham at Homestead, Indian Pocono, this is the chassis.
And the crowd was with him. Fell off by 2/10 on the second lap as Ray Everham checks the time. Elliott is third. It's Dodge, Chevy, Dodge, Ford. And here's Dave Burns with another young up-and-comer.
And let's check the emotion meter for Brian Vickers. Are you relieved? Are you excited after that lap?
The emotion meter, Ryan came up to me, and he held his hand out, and I held my hand out, and that was the emotion meter.
Your hand and Newman's were both shaking.
Just a little bit. We both had it. It was about a tie, but it was it was a good lap. I can't say enough for Ricky Hendrick. Rick Hendrick, Papa Joe Hendrick, they gave me this opportunity. My mom, dad, family, UAW Delphi let me drive this car the last four races. It was a great qualifying effort, Peter. All the guys did a good job. Now we just got to back it up Sunday.
And a great lap was a great birthday present for this now 20-year-old. Matt?
Last fall, Jamie McMurray won a Busch race and finished seventh on the Cup side. So what are you shooting for now, Newman or Vickers?
Well, I mean, you still got to try to go for the pole, but this car really hasn't been a good qualifier. I think we qualified like 20th or something in Indy. But it seems to race well when you take tape off. It doesn't seem to know the difference. So that's not good for qualifying, but it's really good for the race. So just if we can just get the Haviland Dodge in the top 10, it'd be a pretty good day for us.
Hermie Sadler on track in the 0-2 trying to get into this show because in the owner point situation, he's on a go or go home plan. 26th on the first lap, 29.52.
And you know, he was not that bad in practice as far as making the show. He was 32nd quickest. But he just hadn't picked up as much as some of these other guys have picked up.
Now he was doing pretty good down the back straightaway. He's coming back a little bit. Now he's up to 22nd. If he can just get on back to the start finish line, he should be pretty happy with this.
Picked it up by 13/100ths of a second and ends up 23rd. Sadler in the Zapp Creations Chevrolet.
And all he has to beat is four more cars, and he'll be in the show. But I think Dave is with the man that qualified third so far.
The 1988 champion almost had his sixth pole here. Bill, you gave it a good shot.
Well, that daggone round, I just can't beat him. You know, it's here lately. It's, you know, these particular racetracks, he just got it down pat. You know, when you come in and you lay down such a lap right off the bat, it's easier to kind of adjust from there. But we kind of struggled in practice. Mark blew up, and then we just kept working around that and just never could get what we needed.
Yeah, he mentioned the way this started. The day started, guys, in practice. Kind of weird, Mark Martin blowing up, and then they all had to wait before they get on the track.
Well, they'll throw off your rhythm and also shorten your practice time, and both of those can have an effect.
I mean, it was immediately when the racetrack opened for practice.
Another new paint scheme from Kurt Busch. This fellow must walk in the garage every week and wonder which car is his, Jeff. If it wasn't for the 97, he wouldn't know.
I was getting ready to say he's got to look with the transporter's park as well as the number on the car.
Yeah, Jimmy Finney, his crew chief, told me this morning, he said they told Jack Rouse they had to hire some more help for next year in the paint and body shop.
I guess
and
so.
Mainly in the paint shop.
Brute is a Rubbermaid brand, the Sharpie Rubbermaid Ford, and Kurt lays down a lap that is 14th fastest. 29.04.
Considering he was seventh quickest in practice, I don't think they'll be real happy about that.
But again, when you watched him go off in turn one, the car bottomed out extremely hard. All those sparks are very disruptive as far as trying to make that exact
line. Just didn't stay low enough on the racetrack.
Conveying that information back to Jimmy Fennick about what the car was doing during his qualifying.
Felt like he just couldn't keep it down.
Couldn't keep it down.
You want to hear from the driver right after he runs or after he gets out of the car? Which is information better or when it's fresher?
It's all up to him. It really is. I mean, if he wants to talk, go ahead. I'm not going to ask him questions. I'm going to let him just give it up, because a lot of times they're either trying to catch their breath or they're so mad you don't want to hear what they got to say.
Yeah, as long as he can breathe, I want information immediately.
Good point. Dave Blaney, the Jasper Engines and Transmissions, number 77. He's also in the Busch race tomorrow, the Aaron's 312.
Yeah, he was fifth quickest in practice. This is a racetrack that Dave Blaney just picked up on and ran well right from the beginning. I never will forget in his rookie season back in March of 2001, looked like he could not lose this race, and they had a wheel and tire come off of it from loose lug nuts after a pit stop.
He was driving for Bill Davis. Not a good lap, 30.10. That is second from the bottom of the chart. Blaney, not a good birthday present for the just-turned 41-year-old.
And they're on a crew chief search right now. Booty Barker taking a leave of absence a couple of weeks ago. And right now, one of the co-owners, Mark Hara, is resuming the crew chief duties, but they are on a crew chief search, at least for next year for sure.
And that worked out pretty well last week in Martinsville on the short track. They had a good run. Second lap, Blaney picks up to 29.40. That's a big pickup of 6 tenths, and it puts him 25th. Yeah. 34 of 49 drivers have taken time so far here in Atlanta. Mike Joy, Larry McReynolds, Jeff Hammond with you. Jamie McMurray on track in the Haviland Dodge. The stars, you know, start of the season, a star kept getting smaller on the hood of that car. The last 8 or 9 weeks, it's getting bigger again.
And it will start getting bigger next year in their paint scheme as well. Jamie was 12th quickest in practice. Jeff, I'm getting a little bit concerned. All these drivers keep trying to become TV analysts. Now, the word is Jamie's going to be in the booth with Benny Parsons and Alan Bestwick for the Busch race tomorrow on TNT.
You don't say.
That's what I'm hearing.
Well, somebody needs to if Wally's going to be on the track. First lap, 15th for McMurray, 29.05.
Our producer, Sam Flood, says the most concerning thing, though, is people in the booth trying to be race car drivers like Wally Dallenbach.
I'm glad he said that. We didn't.
Exactly.
Second lap for McMurray is slower by 2 tenths. So he is 15th. Bumping will begin officially after the next car. And seven drivers will end up.
Too hard. And one and two.
Bottomed out.
Seven drivers will head for provisional land, and six more will head home. Big field here, 49 cars. I think they had 50 entries, and then one dropped.
We sit here and look at Jamie McMurray now. A year ago, he was driving in the Busch ranks, and he was able to capture a win here in Atlanta. So he's probably got a little bit of a. Donnie Wingo right there talking to him about what was bottoming out. He was talking about the bell housing, which is right there in the center of the car. And when it hits, it really gives a lot of vibrations back through the whole car because of the way it's mounted in the chassis.
Jimmy Spencer from Berwick, Pennsylvania, driving Jim Smith's Dodge, the Sirius Satellite Radio Dodge. Gets another team in search of a sponsor for 2004.
And they've been strong at times. They've looked so good qualifying as well as during the race. I mean, like last week at Martinsville, they had some problems. We came back on the back of the car after they wrecked the practice and were able to qualify in the top five. And Jimmy's, you know, a strong driver, still get the job done. So, a great opportunity for somebody to get on this number seven car.
18th quickest, considering they were 35th quickest in practice, but boy, the car way up the racetrack over there. I think Jimmy knows this lap would not be quicker.
And the speculation around this team centers on crew chief Tommy Baldwin. If you believe what you read on the internet, his toolbox has made more laps around Concord and Mooresville in the last couple of weeks than these drivers have made around the track all weekend.
It's that time of year, man. You know what I'm saying? Everybody's looking to see what they can do for next year.
All right, Matt is with my sleeper pick for the poll here.
And he was fourth fastest in practice. That's Bobby Labonte. Mike Joyce says you are his sleeper pick. How about it? Can you get it up to a 53?
That's really, really fast lap that Ryan and Brian and Bill put up there, fast laps right there. So we ran a a 90 there at the end of practice, I guess it was. So we didn't run that fast on the, at the beginning of practice, but ran a little faster at the end. So it's a good lap for us then. And, you know, hopefully we can back it up with a good fast lap tonight. I think it's going to be exciting. Night qualifying here might be pretty cool. So look forward to it. Get out there and go as fast as we can.
He's won six of the last 13 races here in Atlanta and trying for the sweep, which hasn't been done since 1992 with Bill Elliott.
Here's the Winston Cup point leader, Matt Kenseth.
This does not look too good right down here, what I'm seeing. He was only 31st quickest in practice, and you can hear him right there rolling back out of the throttle over in the middle of turn four, kills the speed of this lap.
In the last four races, Kenseth's lead has been cut by 200 points, including a 33rd at Talladega and a 36th at Kansas.
I mean, the last four races, he's finished outside the top 10 three times. What he has to do, though, these last four races, no matter what Kevin Harvick, Dale Earnhardt Jr. does, as long as he finishes 12th or better, he will be the Winston Cup champion this year.
Well, now, Larry, I talked to Robbie Reiser just prior to qualifying. He said, I said, what'd you think about your qualifying chances? And he says, I'm not really worried about it. I just want to get by this little part of the equation and get on and get ready to race. Not very good. Didn't pick up any kind of speed at all. So they'll have to get it done during the race. But, guys, if he can equal what he did last year in the last four races, he'll be the Winston Cup champion. He finished ninth here in Atlanta. He won at Phoenix. He was eighth at Rockingham. But even though he had a disappointing 40th at Homestead, those three races right there, if he can equal those again, he will be the 2003 champion.
Well, it looks like Sunday he's going to be coming from deep in the chute, provisional land, for Matt Kenseth.
But that's normally where they do their best. I mean, they come from the back and they go to the front.
That's true.
We need to document that bump. This begin the bumping process. Shelby Howard out of the top 36. He will be probably going to the house.
Car owner Jack Roush.
The
team,
other
let's say team owner Jack Roush, because Mark Martin is listed as the owner of Matt Kenseth's car. Johnny Benson, another of the good drivers who has yet to land a ride for next year. Benson caught by surprise as he waggles off turn two there with the news that Scott Riggs would drive this Valvoline Pontiac next season because Benson's contract runs through 2004 with that team.
Yeah, when I saw him at Martinsville last week, I asked him about it. He was definitely pretty much beside himself and surprised with what had happened with the team. He thought he had to ride for next year. But as it is in big-time auto racing, from time to time, things change.
24th for Johnny, a 29-29.
Similar to what he practiced. Looks like he's going to try to make this second lap here. Johnny actually got his very first Winston Cup pole here back in March of 1996. This lap looks like it, well, it did over to the till turn four. Looked like it had potential to be a little better, but he lost a lot of ground coming off turn four. He slows down about a half a tenth.
He'll make his 261st career start on Sunday here. Matt.
And Terry Labonte mixed into a big battle between 7th and 11th. The points. Looks like you guys are back on track, Terry. A 6th last week at Martinsville.
Well, we had a great run last week with our Kellogg Scott Milk Chevy. These guys are doing a great job. I think we've got a good car here for Sunday's race, too.
Both the Labonte brothers have had a lot of success on this racetrack. Ricky Rudd. Air Force colors on the Wood Brothers Ford. And news out of Stuart, Virginia this week that the Wood Brothers are considering moving their entire racing operation to the Charlotte area where many teams are headquartered. The business operation, the museum, would remain up in Stuart, just west of Martinsville, where it's been since Glenn Wood and his brothers founded that team back about 1948.
My people tell me, though, the governor of Virginia was down visiting Stuart, Virginia this past week, talking to them about this. But the most phenomenal story to me here at Atlanta this weekend, when I watch Ricky Rudd go through 3 and 4 here, this will be Ricky Rudd's 800th career Winston Cup start. I know I started 475 races as a crew chief. That seemed like a lifetime. And this is his 800th career start.
Now, I'm sorry I'm doing this from memory, but besides Dave Marcus and Richard Petty, who started more races? I know Terry Labonte is 770 something. He's gaining on it.
D.W. is just
Walters
a little
like
in
809.
Yep, just a little in front of Ricky. Ricky's only going to be 35th quickest, though, runs one lap.
Brian Newman is fastest. Now there's a surprise, but Brian Vickers right now has the outside pole. guess Bobby Labonte would not really be a sleeper pick for the pole because he's had an awful lot of success here. Two poles, seven top 10 starts, and always races well here.
Yeah, you have to watch him in the fall event especially because he's won four of the last seven fall races here.
Green light. As Labonte rolls off into turn number one, this is going to be good.
I mean, he wasn't even into the 170s down in the middle of turn one and two, about 182, 183. 197 going into turn three, and that's the slowest of the two straightaways because the back stretch is short. It's going to be a good lap.
And he was 181 in three and four. Newman was 2 miles an hour faster, and Labonte is second.
And it's
by
close.
4/100ths of a second.
He'll be proud of that run.
And rightly so.
Yes, sir.
Now you know why he's so good at Atlanta. He likes this place. He's got it all figured out. Fatback McSwain is his crew chief right there. They've got a pretty good little handling package when it comes to racing here, too.
And when he starts that close to the front on race day,
watch out.
That shoves Brian Vickers to row two. And there's Michael McSwain.
It's like, how do we run that fast and still be seven?
Did you see the little high in the water that I do? Golly, that close.
I think he just saw the differential between Bobby's lap and Newman's. 4/100ths. The Interstate Chevy. Let's get a word with the crew chief of what's now the second place car.
Do you believe how close that was?
No, I mean, you know, we talked about it earlier. You're going to have to run a 50 or something to sit on the pole. And dadgum, man, I can't believe you run a 53, you run a 57, you know. I've been hanging out with some buddies of mine all week. And I was going to try to get the pole there. And dadgum, we done a good job. The car is really good. This ain't the same car we had here in the spring because we wrecked it
in Chicago.
And the guys did good. They worked really hard. Bobby drove his tail off, so I think we're going to be good on Sunday.
Early on the outside of the front row, barely off the pole. He's still shaking his head.
I mean, and just think about what we're shaking our head over. 4/100ths of a second.
Just the blink of an eye.
I don't think I can blink my eye that quick.
Kyle Petty on Georgia Pacific qualifying night, carrying the sponsor's colors on his number 45 Dodge.
And Kyle's 22nd. On his first lap.
It's about where he practiced.
Yep,
so
he's one and done.
Solid. Yep. Ricky, that bounces Ricky Rudd into provisional land. And Larry Foyt on the danger list, along with Shelby Howard and Billy Bigley. Jeff Burton goes to the bubble.
And his teammate Matt Kenseth has already been bumped into provisional land, which he was close to it when he qualified.
What's the deal after the Busch race for the Victory Junction gang camp that the Petties are building in Randleman, North Carolina? There's going to be a walk around the track to raise money for the Victory Junction gang camp here tomorrow after the Busch race.
Exactly. That's what they're going to be doing. And you know, talk to some of the folks that work with the Speedway Children's Charities around here. They're kind of sponsoring it. And it's, you know, inviting all the drivers and all the fans to come out and walk around the racetrack.
Neat deal. And a great car. The Kellogg's Got Milk Chevrolet for Terry Labonte, who has one pole here, and he'll make his 51st Atlanta start on Sunday, and I believe that leads all active drivers. One more than Bill Elliott, if memory serves.
He was right at 197 miles per hour getting off in turn one. He was 18th quickest in practice.
Leads all active drivers except Ricky Rudd, who will make his 52nd. Start on Sunday.
Same car that Terry won the Southern 500 with last month.
Hear him get out of the throttle right there, Larry?
It's called double dipping. Double dipping is not good.
28 for Labonte, 29-30.
And you know, I was talking earlier on Totally NASCAR this week how neat it would be. Terry Labonte's been in the top 10 in points as he's pretty much one and done. He's ninth in the points for the seventh week. How neat it would be people like Terry Labonte and Bill Elliott to finish in the top 10 in Winston Cup points, Winston's last year of involvement in the sport.
That would be quite fitting. Let's meet the driver who is second fastest right now.
That would be Bobby Labonte, a very fast lap. Were you pleased with it?
Yeah, it really was. Guys did a good job today. Good fast race car, and the car handled really good, and you know, run as fast as we could go. So really proud of it, and really proud of the guys. You know, Fatback and everybody did a good job. So you know, just fast as we can go tonight.
You're always good at this place. I mean, how hard is it to qualify well here?
It's, you know, there's a lot of speed that goes on through here, you know, and you got to really get, you know, just get on the gas and get it and be happy with it. You know, you can't just usually, the way I look at it is, if you slip up a little bit here, it takes your breath. It takes a while to get it back covered up, so good job, man.
And again, the crew chief congratulating the driver, guys.
Mike Wallace, the middle brother of the three, Rusty, Mike, and Kenny.
That was not very pretty.
No, it was.
He just about ran out of racetrack. They somewhat struggled in practice, 42nd quickest. I talked to Mark Reno. There you see just wiggling big time. When you're wiggling like that at these speeds, you're losing speed. They tested down here. He was not very happy with their test. And he's going to be 41st out of 43 cars this week.
And he's on the go or go home list.
Car is bottoming out really bad right there going into turn one. Again, running him up the racetrack, the car just very unstable.
Boy, what a day this team has had. They're on the borderline of making this Winston Cup race. And in the Busch Series with David Streamy in the one car, they missed qualifying inspection. They have to start in provisional land. Not a good day for James Finch's race teams.
Buckshot Jones on the bubble. One of these two will head home off this run, and it would be Wallace, whose second lap is slower by 0.2. Brian Newman, Bobby Labonte, Brian Vickers, and Bill Elliott, quickest so far.
So I got tickets to the game tomorrow night. I wasn't sure if you wanted to go.
Well, it doesn't sound like you want me to go.
What? Of course I want you to go. I just thought maybe, you know, with the crowd and all that.
You'd probably have a better time with Gary.
Gary? No, no, no.
Why don't you ask Gary? And we'll hook up on Saturday.
Okay.
If you're sure.
I'm sure.
Okay, bye-bye. You're in.
Yes!
I'm out! That's
what you say. Action! Remember, when you hit the water, I need you to hide the plane out of control. Water! Remember, out of control. Cut! No, cut! Cut.
Okay, fire the stunt driver.
The new Michelin Hydro Edge with patented hydro chutes. It's our best performing tire in its class. Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires.
From Ron Howard and Imagine Television.
Securities and Exchange Commission.
They have both.
Comes the fall's best new sitcom.
You love it here?
I'm having the time of my life.
Hey, T-Bone.
Arrested Development premieres next month on Fox.
Mark Martin brings the Viagra Ford. Jack Roush onto the speedway. Six drivers left to qualify. Mark was 36th in practice.
But with very few practice laps, you heard Bill Elliott, a lot of drivers talking about, right as the track opened for practice, Mark Martin, those guys exploded an engine. So as you see him bottoming out, pretty much his qualifying effort is for pit picking position only. Regardless of where he qualifies, he will have to start the race at the rear of the field because of the engine change.
If Mark is quick enough, it will bump Buckshot Jones out of the field and out of the race.
And it looks like he's just right there about where Buckshot qualified. And Mark's 34th quickest, so that will bump Buckshot Jones. Now it puts Sterling Marlin on the bubble to head him to provisional land.
Let's show you what happened in practice to Mark Martin. Well, that's a cockpit full of smoke.
And again, he did not even really get up to speed, I think, in practice when this engine let go. Matt, I think you're with Mr. Steve Park.
And he said on the outside of the front row here back in this event, 1999. Well, the track temperature now 73.4, the lowest it's been all night. What do you think?
It's fast. I mean, it's a real fast racetrack. And flying Ryan Newman, he just set a great speed. And the GM car at America Online Chevrolet is... it's a pretty good race car. I told Mike Beam, I said, man, I was watching the times on top of the truck, and I said, I'll run a 90. And then I looked and I said, man, you got to run a 50 now to be on a pole. So I don't know if we have a pole speed in the car, but I think we have a good top 10 run. So I just want to say hello to Jess and April and all the Georgia Posse back home. April just had a baby, so congratulations.
Quickly, what'd you back?
Oh, man, a Coke.
Bobby Gordon on the speedway. A singular wireless Chevy.
Robbie's only Winston Cup pole here came here in March of 1997 driving for Felix Sabatis, and that was the last race on the old configuration racetrack. This used to be a true oval, then they flipped it around during the 97 season and made it the quad oval.
His first lap right now makes him 15th, and talking to Robbie in the garage prior to this qualifying run, he said, I think I've got a shot at these guys, but didn't quite get it done, and he's one and done, and I think it's about all he can stand.
That'll send Sterling Marlin to a provisional start and put Ken Schrader on the bubble. Six drivers will go home. They will include Mike Wallace, Shelby Howard, Billy Bigley, and Buckshot Jones. The next question mark in that group. Well, I think Hermie Sadler just locked in at 31st with four cars to go. He's in. So he dodges a bullet. Bobby Hamilton Jr. on the speedway in the Wawa. Team Marines, number 35. And he's on the go or go home plan.
Yeah, they attempted the race here in March. They missed the show, but had a good qualifying run. They actually had a good car on race day at Kansas last month.
We call it the go or go home plan because this car does not have enough owner points to qualify for one of the seven provisional starts available. So Hamilton must get in the show on time.
But he was pretty good in practice, Jeff. He was 13th quickest, so if he can just come somewhere come close to that. But right now, what I'm seeing, it's going to be very borderline. He's up there in the low 30 qualifying positions. He comes off turn four.
Needs to pick it up. He's picking it up a little bit as he comes back to the start-finish line. Again, that's going to be right there on the border as far as making this race. If he can pick it up a little bit on the second lap.
I think at 33rd with three cars to go, he will be in the show. He's locked in. Barely, but locked in.
And shuts it down. And that will send Larry Foyt to the house. That run. Foyt had already been bounced out of the top 36, but now he falls down the provisional list. So he will be the fifth of six who go home. Three cars to go.
I tell you, Mike, just looking at the lineup right there and the cars that's left, depending on what maybe the 30 car does, Kenny Schrader possibly or Jeff Green could be in trouble here.
I think Schrader has enough owner points to be secure in the field, but it will depend on whether or not Jeff Green's time is fast enough to be in the top 36. So we'll see here in just a little bit.
Craven's getting ready to bring the number 32 car down into turn three and four to get up to his warm-up lap. See what kind of time he can put up for the tie ride.
He was 29th quickest in practice, just decent. See if he'll definitely need to pick up from that, though.
Whoa, boy, bring it back down.
You know, it's such a fine line, especially down in turn one and two. You enter that corner so fast, you know the only way you're going to run fast is not lift off the throttle. But if you miss your mark about a third of a race car width, it'll shoot you up the racetrack at these speeds.
I'm glad you brought that up. I'm kind of curious to see Ricky Craven complete that first lap. He's 24th fastest, solid in the field. But qualifying at night here, a lot of the guys haven't had an opportunity to see this racetrack, and I'm wondering if we're missing their marks maybe just a little bit because of all the speed they carry down in the corner, but these lights give you just a little bit of a different look that you haven't had an opportunity to see before. So some of these guys may be missing these marks because of some of the shadows that are not there during the daylight hours.
Something they've never seen before.
Exactly.
Craven's second lap, half a second off, so he is 24th. Solidly in this field with two cars left to qualify. Craven bumped Mark Martin into a provisional start and moves Scott Wimmer onto the bubble.
So that actually puts three of Jack Roush's cars in provisional land, Mark Martin, Jeff Burton, and Matt Kenseth.
And Larry, you may be right. The going home list may move up to encompass Kenny Schrader. Two cars to go. And I believe it's going to be between Schrader and Jeff Green as far as which of those drivers goes home. Green right now is 35th. If the last two drivers are faster, Jeff Green will join the headed home list. Steve Park in the America Online GM Card Chevrolet. Bright paint job, blue and silver.
Steve was 22nd quickest in practice. He has 8 starts here, set on the outside pole here in November of 99, and then the following year, March of 2000, qualified 3rd and finished 4th, his best weekend here at Atlanta.
Car really looks good. Larry's got it right down on the white line. Don't see it sparking any, so looks like a pretty smooth run for these guys.
It looked like it was wiggling a whole lot. Pretty solid run. 19th quickest for Steve Parker, lap 1, 29-13.
That will bump Scott Wimmer into a provisional, and the Bill Davis team well up in the points, so Wimmer will make the show. And it all comes down to the final car, which will be Dale Earnhardt Jr. Once Steve Park completes his run, must have thought there was a lot more there to go for 2. Mirrors his first lap, so yes, perhaps he left a little something on the table, but as we've often said, you take the good off those tires in the second lap, it's hard to equal the first unless you really missed it on the first lap. So Park, that's a good result. 19th.
Mike, listen to that crowd.
What did his dad used to say? I don't care if they're cheering or booing, I just don't want to get up there and hear nothing.
Exactly.
And we don't normally hear that when this Budweiser car is on the racetrack. Dale Earnhardt Jr., he was 16th quickest in practice.
Talk to Tony Urey Sr. after that practice runs, and they were out there, they were working on this race car pretty diligently because they weren't happy with it at all, making a lot of changes. And it's kind of like, let's see what's going to happen, because they did make a lot of changes.
Whoa, whoa, green light, red light. This run will send either Jeff Green or Kenny Schrader to the house.
Tell you what, it's getting better down the backstretch here. He's losing a little bit of ground, though, about halfway down the backstretch. It's still going to be a pretty good run for Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Junior or the Rocket? Who will sit on the butt pole? Let's find out right here. Last man to qualify. 28-67.
I believe those changes must have agreed with that number 8.
Quite a lap.
Something agreed with it.
Yep.
That knocks Bill Elliott off the second row and sends Jeff Green to the house along with Mike Wallace, Larry Foyt, Shelby Howard, Billy Bigley, and Buckshot Jones. It's over, and the Rocket has won the Bud Pole. Ryan Newman, Bobby Labonte will start outside the front row, and driver 8 will line up 3rd. Matt?
Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s cousin and car chief Tony Jr. challenged you to step it up, and you sure did.
Yeah, that's pretty good. Car's good enough to get the pole. Driver just needed a little more experience, we'll know better next time. But the car was good.
It give you a little motivation?
Yeah, Ryan's time is tough to beat. I mean, that's a fast lap, and those guys have certainly proved that they can win a pole, so congratulations to them, and we'll get a good start, so we'll be great. We'll have to come from the back this time, so we'll already be up there.
Junior starts 3rd. Dave?
Ryan Newman is on his way to Victory Lane, where they give him the Bud Pole Award. Ryan, first of all, congratulations on number 9.
Thanks. Definitely a good team effort. Like I said, we unloaded fast. Man, the guys did an awesome job. Great horsepower and obviously a good car. It's the same car we had in Charlotte. It's a 3-year-old ARCA car, but it still can run some pretty good laps.
All right, and we'll see if he can end up in Victory Lane on Sunday, guys.
The last driver to win 9 poles in a season, Newman's teammate, Rusty Wallace, 2000. Here's a look at the top 10. Veterans, rookies, young guns, hometown hero. What a mixed bag.
It
pretty
is
neat.
A mixed. It pretty really is. So.
But what I'm impressed about is the 25 car, Brian Vickers and Joe Nemechek, both in first-time rides and really looking good.
But how about Kevin Harvick starting 10th when his competitor for the championship, Matt Kenseth, back in provisional land?
And all 4 makes in the top 10, 5 of them Chevys, 2 Dodges, 2 Fords, and a Pontiac as you look through the rest of the field down through 30th position there.
Good run for Derek Cope. Hermie Sadler makes the race.
Bobby Hamilton Jr., the last spot on time, and then the provisionals, including 3 of the Roush cars, as you mentioned. We hit you with a going-home list, 6 of them who failed to qualify. There were 50 cars entered. A.J. Foyt entered both of his cars and then withdrew the 50, so 49 took time. So, first time under the lights qualifying show, pretty cool.
Mile-and-a-half racetrack, almost 195 miles per hour for Ryan Newman.
Congratulations to Ryan Newman on his ninth pole of the year. And now, through the magic of TiVo, we're going straight to us on Trackside. Yeah.